Welcome to worship with Davidson College Presbyterian Church. The service was pre-recorded for Sunday, January 10th, 2021. On the church calendar, it is the baptism of the Lord, the day when we celebrate the baptism of Jesus. And in the life of our community of faith, it's also the day that we are celebrating the ordination and installation of our newest elders and deacons. Jesus was called in baptism. They were called in baptism. We were all called in baptism to ministry, trusting that the Spirit has given us the gifts that are necessary for the work to which we're called. And today we set aside some of our members for special services, deacons and elders. If you're in need of any of the services of our community of faith, spiritual and otherwise, please reach out to the church office and one of the pastors will follow up. Again, welcome to worship with Davidson College Presbyterian Church.
Let's begin by singing a beautiful song. It's based on Psalm 84, which is a reminder of how we long to be in God's presence to worship. So let's be there today. Better is one day.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied, within your presence I sing beneath the shadow.
Set me on fire.
on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully broken. My heart stands in awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You will be with me. You will be with me. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully broken, all to Jesus now.
Please join me in the call to worship. The words will be on your screen, or you can find the bulletin at dcpc.org. I will read the parts that begin with one. Please read the parts that begin with all. In the beginning, when God created, a wind swept over the waters. A breath warmed the dark voids. A spirit called forth creation. God gave in grace. Let there be light for all to see. Let there be water for all to splash in. Let there be life in the midst of death. Yes, let there be life beyond death. And God invited and invites us to respond, rejoicing. It was good. It was awesome and awe-filled. It is good. Let us worship God.
God, you spin the true reflection be of your church.
God's gift of life is grace itself, yet life can go awry, sometimes because we have lived in ways that are not faithful to those who are grateful to God. Yet grace continues and abounds in forgiveness. Please join me in our unison prayer of confession, followed by a time for silent confession. Good and gracious God, bring us to the waters to cleanse us from that which weighs us down, those things we carry that separate us from one another and from you. Forgive us, we pray, for the burdens we have placed upon ourselves and others, burdens of injustice, burdens of selfishness, burdens of closed-mindedness. Through the waters of our baptism, renew us and send us forth that we may live to serve you more fully. Amen. Friends, without water there can be no life. But God does not leave us parched. God protects and preserves us. Through the waters of our baptism, I announce to you that our sins are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen.
Welcome to worship with Davidson College Presbyterian Church. We're a member congregation of the Presbyterian Church USA. We are also a Matthew 25 Stephen Ministry Earth Care congregation, to whom the mental health of our members, friends, and community matters. As we said earlier, today is the day where we ordain and install the newest officers in our denomination and in our church. We ask the blessing of the Spirit upon them, and it is in that same spirit that we would like to be praying for you and to know that you're a part of our life together. We encourage you to sign the online friendship pad by using the link in the chat and comment section or sending an email to a staff member. Also in the chat and comment section, you'll find a link to online giving. We are grateful for everybody who supports our ministries. We believe that our community is a more hopeful place because of you. So thank you. When it comes to the gifts of our members and friends, we're thankful that today Hallie Stewart and Jack Hansen, Davidson College students, gave us the gift of their leadership as liturgists. I know our homeless neighbors are grateful for those who are willing to share our gifts of time and talent and treasure by providing lunches for the local homeless shelter called Roof Above. You can find out more about making lunches for Roof Above in our bulletin. Also in our bulletin, there's an opportunity for our fourth and fifth graders to be of service to our neighbors in our Martin Luther King Jr. Day of Service. Information about signing up for that day is also in the bulletin. And then when it comes to the mind of our members and friends, you are welcome to join us for Short Story Theology this Tuesday as we talk about the short story, This Is the Only Time I'll Tell It by Doris Betts. And friends and admirers of Tony Abbott will look forward to an evening together on January 27th to celebrate Tony's life and his legacy. Registration information is in the bulletin. And finally, our youngest children, our elementary age children, are invited to join us for a weekly Sunday school class by Zoom every Sunday morning. More information with Jenny Alexander, including a Zoom sign-up link. Again, welcome to worship with Davidson College Presbyterian Church.
Please join me in our unison prayer for illumination as we ask God to bless the reading, singing, and preaching of God's Word. Holy God, creator of light and herald of goodness, at the waters of his baptism, you proclaimed Jesus, your beloved Son. With the baptized of every time and generation, may we say yes to your call to repentance and be led to the life of abundance we experience in your kinship and your love. Amen.
Good morning. Here we are in the chapel. I thought you might enjoy being in this space with me and coming in close so we can talk for a minute. Friends, when I was younger, I used to really enjoy learning some American Sign Language. And I thought maybe we could do a little bit this morning to tell our Bible story. You know, when you see American Sign Language, it kind of helps the words come to life a little bit. So let's try this together. Do what I do and say what I say. God, God, create, create, heaven, heaven, earth, earth, it's just your middle finger and your thumb on your fist, earth, darkness, darkness, light, put all your fingers together, out front, light, light, and good. Touch your lips, and touch your hand, good. So listen to the word of God and do what I do. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep sea, and God's wind swept over the waters. God said, "Let there be light." And so light appeared. God saw how good the light was. God separated the light from the darkness, and God named the light day and the darkness night. That's the story of creation, day one. Now, friends, we live on this big earth during the day and during the night. It's the same earth, but have you ever thought about how differently we see things in the day and we see them in the night? How differently we feel things in the day and in the night? At night, when things are dark, we just don't see very well. We might feel uncomfortable or unsure. And then we turn on a light in a dark room and we see. And we may then feel sure and comfortable once again. In the Bible, we hear that Jesus, and you know that one, is the light. And God certainly created the light in the world, as we just heard from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. Have you ever noticed that when things are difficult and you remember God, when you truly focus on God, how you can find hope and joy? For example, maybe you've had a hard day or a tough week. How do you feel when you come to church and open your heart? When you sing a song and really focus on God, do you find a little bit of light? Maybe you find some peace in those uncomfortable places. Now, I hope the next time that you feel some darkness, I dare you to reach out to God, reach out, truly focus on God, and see if God can bring some light to you. Ask God for whatever it is you need. Pray, listen, look for Jesus all around you. Let God surprise you when God turns on the light in your uncomfortable places. Let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, sometimes we feel sad or uncomfortable. Help us ask you to turn on the light. Thank you for creating light in this world. Thank you for creating light and hope in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first reading from the Bible today comes from the first book of the Bible, from the opening verses, in fact. It is the first part of the first creation story. Listen now to one version, the poetic and majestic version of the beginning. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
New Testament passage this morning comes from the book of Acts. It's important to remember that Acts, the story of the early Christian church, is a continuation of Luke's gospel. Hear now these words from Acts 19, verses 1 through 7. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul took a route through the interior and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you came to believe?" They replied, "We've not even heard that there was a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "What baptism did you receive then?" They answered, "John's baptism." Paul explained, "John baptized with a baptism by which people showed that they were changing their hearts and lives. It was a baptism that told people about the one who was coming after him. This is the one in whom they were to believe. This one is Jesus. After they listened to Paul, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in other languages and prophesying. Altogether, there were about 12 people. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I wonder what you remember from your baptism, or more likely, what you've been told about your baptism. Was it a big day with lots of family and friends in attendance, or perhaps a more quiet, subdued affair? Last Monday night, I was asking our young adults to think about their baptisms, or maybe a baptism that stood out to them, and one of them shared the following video from YouTube. Another young adult shared that growing up, she was baptized, but her brother was not. Around age 8 or 9, he found this out. And when the friendship pad was passed, he would write his name and then he would check guest. His parents soon had him baptized. It's curious why baptism is so important to us. Why is it that all Christians can agree that the command Jesus gave us to be baptized can unite us, but at the same time, the how and when we baptize divide and fracture us? Our passage today in Acts 19 points to many of the issues that have fueled this debate over the centuries. In our tradition, we most often baptize babies, but not always. What theological statement are we trying to make? In baptism, we are called to a new way of life as Christ's disciples, sharing the good news of the gospel with all the world. Presbyterians describe baptism as a sign and seal of the covenant of grace made by God through Jesus and extended to us. In baptism, God claims us as beloved children and members of Christ's body, the church, washing us clean from sin as we renounce the power of evil and seek the will and way of God. Infant baptism expresses that it is God who chooses us for faith, discipleship, and salvation. Without God, we have no power to claim these things for ourselves. However, we affirm that people come to faith in different stages in life and recognize the baptism of older believers as an equally valid expression of the sacrament. Baptism is central to our identity as Christians. And so this Sunday, the day we celebrate the baptism of the Lord, provides an opportune time to focus on that identity. What does it mean for us to be marked as Christ's own and to embrace a life dedicated to God? How do we live out those promises? How seriously do we take them, whether we make them for ourselves or as parents or sponsors or on behalf of our children? In the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark, we meet John, cousin of Jesus. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. He announced, "One stronger than I am is coming after me. I am not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. John was an original, or what we would call today an influencer. He called into question the accepted practices and preached a repentance and change to the way things are going. The idea of Christian being the hegemonic with culture woven into the very fabric of society is definitely not how Christianity started. Here is Radical John pointing the way to Jesus, proclaiming in the midst of his power and influence that one far more powerful and impactful than him will follow. And then comes Jesus with a quieter and more subtle power. Jesus lends his authority to John's baptism and affirms the power of baptism himself by being baptized. His choice is clearly affirmed by God. "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased." Indeed, this is the power of baptism, for it seals God's love for us. Though we are enveloped by God at birth, at baptism, we claim what God has already done for us, called us God's own. The power of God's love proves to be mighty, empowering, enabling us to love and accept people beyond our own human capacity. This power is affirmed in Acts 19, verses 1 through 7, where Paul affirms that there is only one baptism, and that is in the name of Jesus Christ. Back in an age when people would seek out the original disciples to baptize them and then brag to each other who that they were baptized by Paul or John. Paul explains that it is God who empowers baptism, and it is not reliant upon the hands of the baptizer. This clarifies how it is John the Baptist can baptize Jesus. For though it legitimized baptism itself and was a great honor, it was in no way dependent upon John the Baptist being perfect enough to baptize Jesus. For no one is perfect enough to baptize Jesus. We often think perfection is powerful, but Jesus and John the Baptist, in the dirt and sweat of the wilderness, choosing as common an element as water without special anointing or sacrifices, show us that the power is God's and isn't really about perfection after all. So too, when God created the world in Genesis 1 through 5, God does not discuss superiorities of one thing over another. We humans tend to prefer light, but in the midst of the desert, shade and dark can be a restful comfort. God does not call his creation perfect, for God did not create us in the world to be perfect. God proclaims creation and humans good. God separates creation into pieces and categories so that they can interact and relate to one another. What is the light without the darkness? What is the darkness without the light? They are in relationship with one another, and God created the entire cosmos in the same relational manner. The baptism of Jesus by John inaugurated Jesus's earthly ministry. It marked the moment when he was designated God's son by a voice from heaven and was endowed by the Spirit to carry out his work on earth. Likewise, in Christian baptism, this event marks the inauguration of a new life and vocation for the one being baptized. Luke writes that those who were baptized spoke in tongues and prophesied. The speaking in tongues recalls the speaking in other tongues in the Pentecost story. In addition, the people baptized prophesy. They give testimony in their own language concerning Jesus. While not all Christians who have been baptized have the gifts of tongue or prophecy, the giving of them reminds us of two things. First, all Christians are endowed by the Spirit, and there are many gifts. Secondly, we are reminded that being baptized entails the use of whatever gifts one has to witness what God has done in Christ. We all have different gifts and abilities, and God calls us to use those to glorify God. How are you living out your call as God's beloved? Where and how are you sharing what you know of Christ with others? When have you fed the hungry, welcomed the stranger, clothed the naked, cared for the sick, or visited those in prison? Jesus reminds us that when we do the least of these for our brothers and sisters, you have done it for me. Today, we ordain and install those called to serve as deacons and elders here at Davidson College Presbyterian Church. You have called these women and men to serve in these offices because you recognize their gifts of leadership. In a moment, they will be asked a series of questions, but three stand out for me. Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture, and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? And for elders, will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? And for deacons, will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Christ Jesus? Looking back to our Genesis passage, we hear that God's wind swept over the water. In Hebrew, God's wind or spirit is translated as ruach. It is that same spirit that descended on Jesus at his baptism and in our baptism too. And when we ordain and install our officers, we pray God's ruach will be with them. That spirit enables us to live as God's beloved and to live out our baptismal vows. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Our next song comes from Africa. It's called Tumamina. We'll sing two parts, a lower and a higher. We'll start with the lower.
Tumamina, Tumamina, Tumamina so mandla.
Tumamina, Tumamina, Tumamina so mandla.
Melody.
Tumamina, Tumamina, Tumamina so mandla. Tumamina, Tumamina, Tumamina so mandla.
Send me, Lord,
send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Jesus, send me Lord.
Lead me, Lord,
lead me Jesus. Lead me, Jesus, lead me, Lord.
Fill me, Lord,
fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus. Fill me, Jesus, fill me, Lord. Tumamina, so my love.
Today we are blessed to ordain and install some of the newest officers in our denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, and the newest officers in the life of Davidson College Presbyterian Church. And while we can't gather and do that ordination and installation in the ways in which we have become accustomed, we are grateful that nonetheless, through the gift of technology, we are able to do this ordination and installation. And we're grateful that by the gift of the Spirit, we are as connected as we need to be for this time and for this moment in the life of our congregation. And so we begin now with the ordination and installation of our officers.
There are a variety of gifts, but it's the same Spirit who gives them. There are different ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. God works through each person in a unique way, but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. To each is given a gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together, we are the body of Christ and individually members of it.
We are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our common calling, to be disciples of Jesus Christ and servants of our Lord. Within the community of the church, some are called to particular service as deacons, as ruling elders, and as ministers of word and sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us. Through ordination, God provides for acts of care and compassion in the world, for the ordering and governance of the church, and for the preaching of the word and celebration of the sacraments.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of Davidson College Presbyterian Church now ordains Alexander Hazel to ministry as a deacon and ordains Abby Guise and Stephanie Glazer to ministry as ruling elders and installs them to active service in this congregation.
And Larry has introduced our candidates for becoming officers. And I should have said earlier that we are blessed, in addition to our new officers, to have John Ryan and Claire George Drumheller, part of the pastoral staff at Davidson College Presbyterian Church, and our clerk of session, Larry Kane, representing that body. Now, God calls some to particular forms of ministry, and God calls us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ given to all of us in the covenant of baptism. Let us therefore together, all of us, reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask all of us on the Zoom call, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? If so, please say, I do. I do.
I do. I
do. Do you turn to Jesus Christ, accept him as Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
And will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, please say, I will with God's help. I will,
With God's help.
Let us with the whole church confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's a more contemporary ecumenical version of that creed. And the words will also be printed upon the screen so that those of you who are joining us in worship on Saturday and Sunday can join in reciting that creed. So let us confess our faith together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again.
He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right
to give thanks and praise.
Gracious and eternal God, with joy we give you thanks and praise. We praise you for leading your people Israel through the waters of the sea, out of bondage and into freedom, into the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus, your Son, who for us was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed as the Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you for pouring out your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with a variety of gifts, that we may proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. We rejoice that you have claimed us in our baptism and anointed us for the service in Christ's name, and that by your grace we are born anew. By your Holy Spirit, renew us that we may be empowered to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit are all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen. Friends, remember your baptism and be thankful. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now, Stephanie and Alexander and Abby, all of us who have been ordained to any of the ministries of the Presbyterian Church have answered a series of ordination questions, and we had sent those to you prior to tonight, and invite you now to offer your answers in the affirmative to those questions. And same with the questions of our baptismal vows. Larry and Claire and John and I will join you in also answering most of those questions. This is a fun opportunity for us in many ways to reaffirm our commitments to the promises that we made at our ordinations as well. And so to all of us, in baptism, you were claimed by the love of God, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ, and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. And now you are called by God through the voice of the church for service and ministry in Jesus' name. So in accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA, I invite you to show your commitment to this calling by responding to these questions. Do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledging him Lord of all, head of the church, and through him, believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
I do. I
do. Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ and the Church Universal and God's word to you? Do you?
I do.
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church, as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you?
I do, and I will.
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
I will.
Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you?
I do.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you?
I will.
And now, Abby, a question for you. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, directing the people's abbey. You are the elder. Alexander, you are the deacon. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
And for Abby and for Stephanie, will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? And will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
For the congregation, do we, the members of the church, accept Alexander, Abby, and Stephanie as ruling elders and deacons, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we?
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? Do we?
We do.
And for those who wonder if that was the voice of God coming down out of the clouds like Jesus' baptism, that's Thomas Hazel, who is slightly off camera, but is helping Larry be a representative of the wider congregation. So thank you, Thomas. That was good to hear your voice. Now, something for those who are used to seeing an ordination installation in the church is this is the time when we would normally invite those who've been ordained as elders and as ministers of word and sacrament to come forward to lay their hands upon those who are being ordained. And tonight, I keep saying tonight, I know you're seeing this on Saturday and Sunday, but those who are being ordained tonight, they are being ordained and installed. And so you can see we've got these special backgrounds, these virtual images, to represent the Holy Spirit. You've got the dove between Stephanie and Alexander above Claire's head, just off John's shoulder. You've got the red and symbolizing the flames of the Holy Spirit right over my shoulder, someone who literally is having the laying on of hands. All of these are symbols of our desire to make sure that Abby and Alexander and Stephanie know that there is a whole gathering of people who by the Spirit are seeking to bless them as officers. So it may be that for those of you who are at home, join us in expressing that prayer for them. You might, I know it doesn't feel very Presbyterian, you might hold your hand up at home. You might simply just reach out in front of you or simply bow your head in prayer with us. But in whatever way feels comfortable to you, join your hearts and your spirit with ours as we ask God's blessing upon our newest officers. And again, the Lord be with you. And also
with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Gracious and eternal God, with joy we give you thanks and praise. Throughout the ages and in every place, you have chosen servants from among your people to point the way to salvation by your grace. We are grateful for ancestors in the faith who followed without fear, placing their trust in you alone, for judges and monarchs who ruled in righteousness and peace, for prophets and apostles who spoke your bold words of mercy and of truth, for leaders and teachers in every age who have nurtured your people in faith and faithfulness.
Above all, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Anointed by your Holy Spirit, he proclaimed your reign on earth, revealing your saving love in all he did and said. Gracious God, pour out your spirit upon your servants, Abby, Alexander, and Stephanie, whom you've called by baptism as your own. Grant them the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Give them a spirit of truthfulness that they may show the compassion of Christ in the actions of daily living and rightly governing your people. By the gifts of your Holy Spirit, empower them to build up the church, to strengthen the common life of your people, and to lead with compassion and vision. In the walk of faith and for the work of ministry, give all your servants gladness and strength, discipline and hope, humility, humor, and courage, an abiding sense of your presence.
Gracious God, pour out your spirit of power and truth upon the whole church, that we may be for you a holy people, baptized to serve you in the world. Sustain your church and ministry, ground us in the gospel, secure our hope in Christ, strengthen our service to the outcast, and increase our love for one another. Show us the transforming power of your grace in our life together, that we may be effective servants of the gospel, offering a compelling witness in the world to the good news of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. And Alexander and Abby and Stephanie, you are now deacons and ruling elders ordained to ministries of service and governance in the Church of Jesus Christ and in our congregation. Welcome to that ministry.
Stephanie, Alexander, and Abby, welcome indeed. And I will invite you to hear these words from Colossians as you are charged to ordained ministry. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen.
A charge to the congregation. Above all, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen.
Before we turn to our final song and benediction for today, we do want to stop and pray for our country. So many of us were dismayed and in some level fearful with the events that exploded into our national life on Wednesday. Is a mob took over our United States Capitol. I'm thankful that since Wednesday and since our prayer service, and thank you for everyone who came out to that prayer service and everybody who's viewed it, you were a gift to the pastors as well as to friends and members of this church who knew there were other people anxious, other people praying, other people trusting in God. I'm thankful that things are coming into view in terms of what politicians will do and how our country is responding to what happened and what should happen. And when it comes to us and the church, we have a sense of what we need to do as well. I hope we can live into the mantra that a friend of mine reminded me of this week. We pray as if it's all up to God and we work as if it's all up to us. And friends, there is plenty of work to do. Issues of justice, when we are clear about the treatment of white, violent mobs invading our Capitol versus the response to Black Lives Matter protesters in our nation's capital. When we see a Confederate flag carried into the halls of that building, when we see anti-Semitic t-shirts, friends, there is much to do in our country in terms of racial justice. And there's clearly much to do in terms of reconciliation. And we are called to that work. And as we are called to that work, we remember parts of our scriptures that help us to trust that we're not alone. We're reminded that I have redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames shall not consume you. For it is there in Isaiah that we're told that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And then in the Psalm 130, we are reminded that we wait and hope in the Lord. With the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him there is great power to redeem. And then it is Jesus who tells those of us still living with the dismay of these events that blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Friends, with those promises of Scripture in our ears and hearts, please join me in prayer. Gracious God, the news of this week, it has brought us low. And some of us have been living and walking in fear and worry, anxiety, feeling as though we walk through the dark valley. In the depths of anger and fear, we have come to you, our God, our rock, our refuge, our comfort, our hope, and we pray that you would surround us with your everlasting arms. Hear our cries of despair, heed our calls for justice, do not let us lose hope. For our help comes from you, O Lord, you who made heaven and earth. In the midst of fear, you are our anchor. In the face of uncertainty, you are our rock. In the midst of tragedy, you are our hope. So even as we weep and wonder, we praise you. We place our trust in you. And mighty and merciful God, lover of justice and equity, by the power of your Holy Spirit, make us brave advocates for your justice, instruments of your peace, so that our country might finally be the place that you call us, the people you call us to be, a place of racial equality and justice. Gracious God, keep safe those who are in danger and continue to work your peace into the life of our nation's capital and into all of our hearts. May calm spread over our country in the coming days. Keep us working and praying for the day when your justice will roll down like waters, your righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, and fill us with the peace that passes all understanding, the deep peace of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And Lord, we pray for all of this in the midst of a pandemic that rages on. And so we pray that you who have always been faithful to your people, that you would come now, give comfort and courage to those who are suffering, give strength and skill to those who are working to save and to heal, and open our eyes and hearts and hands to the movements of your Spirit, that we might be comforted and comfort others in the name of Christ, who is our healer and our light. Our help comes from you, O Lord. In the midst of grief, you are comfort. In the face of uncertainty, you are a rock. In the wake of tragedy, you are our hope. So even as we weep, we praise you and we place our trust in you. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And friends, as we enter that world to do God's work, remember these words: to go out into the world in peace, to have courage, to hold on to what is good, return no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering, honor all people, love and serve the Lord.
All right, as we go from this place, let's remember the call that we have to serve one another with all the gifts that God has given us.
Will you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey. We're together on the road. We are
Go forth into the world to live as those baptized into Christ's mission. And may the eternal light of God keep you rock solidly immersed in the river of life, in the peace and power of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. And also with you.